When an athlete crosses the finish line at an Olympic Games, the story of those Games is far from over. Today, Olympic legacy, what's left behind, is just as important as the sporting spectacle itself. These days, Olympic success is not just measured in medals, records, and in iconic images. It's as much about the lasting benefits that the Games can bring to a host city and nation. Historically, though, legacy hasn't always been part of the planning process. But now, things are very different. When a city is elected to host an Olympic Games, it's not just writing its place into the history books. It has a very clear opportunity to create lasting change for its citizens long after the Games is finished.
The benefits can be defined in two ways: the tangible legacies. Sports venues, urban renewal, transportation, the environment, the economy, and just as important, the intangible legacies: national pride, cultural awareness, a healthy lifestyle, and community involvement. Legacies that can make a real difference in people's everyday lives.
So, how has Olympic legacy evolved over the last century? And how has the IOC played its part in embedding into the consciousness of a host city, and indeed a host nation, that ambition for long-term benefits? We start the story here in Stockholm's Olympiastadion, host venue for the 1912 Olympic Games.
You can feel the distant echoes of sporting glory in the corridors and passageways of this much-loved stadium. It may be one of the smallest in the history of the Olympic Games, but it's produced more world records than many other track and field arenas.
Unlike so many historic sports arenas, this place has remained largely untouched by the years, and we have the city of Stockholm to thank for that. And 100 years on, this place is a powerful testimony that the Olympic spirit still burns brightly here.
The football team, Djurgården, they were thinking of taking the track away. It's like taking the heart out of the stadium. I think the Olympic Stadium keeps the sport together, and to participate in Stockholm for every athlete is something special.
Is there also a sense of the younger generation feeling pride? They've got this sense of history, and that Stockholm is an Olympic city.
Yeah, and they feel it when they come here. As soon as you enter here, you feel a little bit of the history. Our main goal is to make young people more physically active. So that's going to be our legacy from this Jubilee.
It's really nice to be training in the stadium, which has such a cultural history. The Olympics will always be a part of my heart.
Even when a city isn't successful in its bid to host the Games, its Olympic ambition can still inspire change.
Hammarby Sjöstad was intended to form part of Stockholm's bid for the 2004 Summer Olympic Games. The city lost out to Athens, yet the bid was a real impetus to continue with the development and use it as a pilot for environmentally friendly housing. The area has been transformed from a polluted ex-industrial site into a popular neighbourhood for young families.
We wanted to build the first environmental Olympic village in the world. So with very much environmental thinking, material choices, waste sorting, transportation, etc. That is how Hammarby Sjöstad was built. The environmental agenda was quite high at the time, just some few years after the Rio conference. And this was the opportunity to actually make this happen.
And this isn't just a summer phenomenon. Winter Games have also created positive Olympic legacies.
In 1932, the Winter Games came to America for the first time, to Lake Placid. A multi-purpose Olympic center was built specially for the Games, the first indoor arena ever used for the Winter Olympics. In 1980, the Olympic Games focused the world's attention once again on Lake Placid. In the original 1932 Olympic Centre, the US men's hockey team defeated the heavily favoured Soviet Union in a match that became known as the Miracle on Ice. But the legacy of the 1980 Games could well have been limited to some great memories and short-term improvements in infrastructure, if not for the creation of the Olympic Regional Delivery Authority in 1981. This organisation was set up to manage and promote the sports facilities used to host the 1980 Games and has created an ongoing legacy that has reshaped the region's economy. Since then, Lake Placid has hosted an impressive 11 World Championships and 60 World Cup events. The continual enhancement of the Olympic facilities has ensured that the Olympic legacy not only lives on, but is built upon. The tangible legacy of sporting infrastructure is, in many ways, the most straightforward part. You have to build venues to stage the Games. But in 1992, Barcelona took this whole concept of Olympic legacy to another level. Their approach in staging the Games was to be a turning point in the way that a host city could use the Olympics to not just provide new sports facilities, but to transform its urban landscape, strengthen its position on the world map, and create broader social and environmental benefits. Barcelona's legacy master plan was clear. It decided to carry out ambitious projects that would benefit the city as a whole, convinced that what was good for the residents would also be good for the Olympic movement. For the first time in its history, the city of Barcelona was able to turn and face the sea with pride.
Barcelona estaba de espaldas al mar. Era una ciudad que tenía una costa fantástica, pero que no estaba aprovechada. La ciudad no podía llegar al mar. Entonces, yo creo que el hacer el puerto olímpico, el poner la villa olímpica al lado del mar, pues lograron que la ciudad pudiera tener acceso a lo que es la Barcelona de hoy en día.
This area was an industrialized area. Industries obsolete, many of them were closed. So we did a big investment here. But when the Games were over, most of the 2,000 apartments were already sold. We wanted to have younger people with young children, so all this will help to, let's say, balance the city in some way.
Los juegos deben estar al servicio de la ciudad y no la ciudad al servicio de los juegos, porque los juegos son efímeros y las ciudades son permanentes. Claro, turísticamente, Barcelona en aquel momento recibía 1,7 millones de turistas. Y el último año, 1911, ha recibido 7,4. Los Juegos transformaron profundamente la ciudad. Tan profundamente que 20 años después eso se vive todavía como algo que fue ayer.
Pero indudablemente ha fomentado muchísimas aficiones y sobre todo ha cambiado la mentalidad de los españoles con respecto al deporte.
Los Juegos Olímpicos son mucho más que un acto deportivo. Es muy importante, creemos nosotros, que para nuestra juventud y para la ciudadanía, los valores que impregnan el olimpismo y el deporte sigan vivos porque ayudan a la mejora de nuestra juventud y a la formación de los menores.
...1992 was also the year of Agenda 21, the Global Partnership for Sustainable Development, signed at the Earth Summit in Rio. This international focus on sustainability struck a chord with Barcelona's philosophy and has now become embedded in the DNA of the IOC. Only 7 years on, the IOC established its own Agenda 21.
Later in 1994, the Winter Olympics in Lillehammer put into practice what was now an important legacy policy, respect for the environment.
Some 50 kilometres away from the centre of Lillehammer lies the Jovik Olympic Cavern Hall, the world's largest cavern for public use. It was the location for ice hockey in the 1994 Winter Olympic Games and will host short track speed skating in the Youth Olympic Games in 2016. The hall is a strong symbol of Lillehammer's environmental approach to hosting the Games.
This arena If you should build it in like an ordinary outdoor arena, it would be huge. But now we are in the middle of the town, but no one sees us from the outside. The special thing in here, and what makes it very environmental, is that there is no outside maintenance, and we are able to use the technology to heat up the venue with the energy from making the ice. That was a very, very young technology in 1993 when this venue was built. It's still effective.
Lillehammer set new standards for major sports events. It sent out a strong message to future event organisers that environmental protection measures can and should be part of their operating mandate.
The environment was built in at an early stage. We worked very closely with the IOC and with the NGO. I think the most interesting part was perhaps our efforts to try and change the attitude of people, that they should be concerned, that they should learn why we did this.
The stone were actually taken from the ski jump arena when it was built. That was also my intention, that the metal should come out from the natural environment here in Norway, and like also the Olympic idea here at Lillehammer, it should be integrated in the landscape as much as possible and also be a part of the natural environment.
I think the legacy of 1994 is still alive, not only in Lillehammer and the areas around Lillehammer, but also in the Olympic movement. And the Green White Games started in 1994 in Lillehammer, and it's been developed for every Olympic Games afterwards.
Sydney 2000, the first games of the 21st century and the sporting extravaganza that everyone expected it to be. It also became known as the first Green Summer Games, winning the United Nations Environmental Programme Global Roll of Honour in 2001.
Like Barcelona, the Games accelerated Australia's international profile in a way that wouldn't have been possible otherwise. And in a more gradual evolution, Sydney's Olympic Park has now become a major sporting, recreational and urban centre.
After having won the Games, there was a lot more attention given to the planning, to the sustainability, the environmental aspects than had been given beforehand. The sports organisers and the government certainly understood that they had to have something sustainable and a legacy that would work into the future. This was a large unused area of Sydney. It was crying out for something to be done. And as well as building these sports venues, which Sydney was badly in need of, there was enough land to have an adjoining Olympic Village, which has subsequently been sold and is home to 6,000 people now. And since the Games, there's been $1.5 billion of commercial development. Office towers have gone in. There's a daily working force on the site now of 13,000 people.
Copy up.
So the population has grown at the park, and with it the use has grown. And it's a thriving community now.
The Penaflight Water Stadium here was originally built for the 2000 Olympics, so it's great to still have it here 12 years later, and it's definitely contributed to my success and Australia's success as a whole.
We had the Harbour Bridge, we had the Opera House, now we're in Olympic City.
Jacques Rogg was chair of the IOC's Coordination Commission for Sydney, helping to shape one of the best staged games ever. Now, as president of the IOC, he is passionate about the IOC's role in helping host cities to prepare for legacy.
The Games do not stop by the closing ceremony. They have to leave something tangible for the population, something that's really a benefit for the generations to come.
How much work does the IOC do with host cities to make sure that there is such a legacy?
We discussed with them at the very beginning of the bid, and we asked them to reflect on what should they leave for their own population. We come up with examples of the past, so we give the experience of the previous games, and we help them and we support them in defining their own legacy, because each city has its own legacy.
How important do you think are Olympic athletes to creating that legacy?
They are of paramount importance. They are number one. You know, athletes break barriers. Look at Beijing. Look at the times in the 100 meter with Usain Bolt. He's created a new world. You yourself have created a new world. We're still waiting for your successors, but but you know, in the imagination of people, what you have done in jumping so far has broken a barrier. There is no limit anymore.
In 2008, Beijing produced some of the most epic sporting performances the world has ever seen. Their games also introduced sport to more countries than ever before, with unprecedented global reach both in terms of athletes and spectators. China opened its doors and quite literally welcomed the world. Beijing was a games carried out on a breathtaking scale as well as with breathtaking performances. But the IOC knew that its success wouldn't simply be judged by the breaking of records. Beijing was a vivid example of the games' legacy in action, touching millions of people. Many new sports venues were constructed, mainly within the perimeter of local universities, maximising post-games usage. A huge renovation of the Beijing Metro, the renewal of the bus fleet with cleaner vehicles, as well as an upgrade of the heat and electricity generation across the capital with more efficient and less polluting technologies. The social legacy. From the 250,000 Chinese schools learning about the Olympic values to the 100,000 volunteers for the Games, forever changed by their experience. And the sporting legacy. Elite and grassroots sport has found a new place to grow in China. So, 4 years on, how has the legacy endured?
Beijing奥运会呢，给北京这座城市它的长久的发展，不管是它的经济、城市建设、政治，以及它的文化，以及它的环境，都留下了深刻的影响。
广大市民啊，他已经把这个参加体育锻炼变成了一种生活的方式，也就是说，他成为了衣食住行啊这个生活要素的第五个要素，就是健身。水立方作为一个旅游目的地，作为一个重要的奥运遗产，那么它实行了这种非常低的票价政策，儿童、老人。
这些残障人士是实行的半免票政策，我们一直在坚持这个体育场馆的这个性质，它这个性质并没有改变。就是说，让人们就是多运动运动，不管是以后他还是从事体育方面，还是说接轨国际上的一些工作。
这都是对他们以后一个终身难忘的一笔财富吧。就北京来说呢，我们感觉到很重要的一点呢，是把奥运会的筹办工作呀和城市的发展结合起来，特别是呢，和造福于人民、解决人民生活当中的重要问题结合起来。The
most valuable single legacy left by the Olympic Games is the Olympic spirit. The Olympic spirit deeply affects the city and its population.
The games of the last two decades have proved beyond any doubt that legacy doesn't happen by accident. It has to be planned for, created, and nurtured. Each new host city and host nation learns the lessons from previous games, but the IOC itself is in a unique position to help define the vision, plan the legacy objectives, and identify the long-term benefits that the games can bring right from the very start of the bidding process. And this is exactly what happened in Vancouver.
Sustainability was one of those values that every single person in the organization had to subscribe to, believe in, and it was embedded in our decision making. It became simply part of who we were.
The Vancouver Games were unique in the way the social, environmental, and economic considerations were interwoven to benefit the people of Vancouver and its surrounding regions. The Richmond Olympic Oval hosted speed skating during the Games, but its vision was clear well before construction began.
The number one thing was we wanted to tread lightly on this environment. We're right by the Fraser River, and we wanted to make sure that we respected, you know, the environment around us. And also, when we built a structure of this magnitude, it's like 45, 48,000 square meters, it's huge. What are we gonna do with it after?
We wanted a place which would be the hub of activity for an entire neighborhood, and if you look around the Oval today, you'll see all the development that is taking place. The catalyst for that was this Richmond Olympic Oval, and the catalyst for the Oval was the Olympic Games.
All you have to do is come in here and you see people of all ethnic backgrounds, all ages. You're just thrilled. This has just been probably one of the best things that's ever happened to our community.
I come here every day. I get so much benefit because it improved my health.
We dedicated this facility to the Olympic Games, but we didn't design it and build it for the Olympic Games. We did it for community legacy, and that's where the payback is.
Yeah.
Good.
Sustainability was linked to social inclusion in Vancouver's fabrication shop, with the construction of 11,000 items that were needed to stage the Olympic Games.
Our mandate was to build as many of the wooden products for the Olympics as we could, and also take inner city youth or youth at risk, train them in carpentry, and try and give them a new start in life.
What I learned from the program is just work ethic. I never really had any when I first started, jumping from job to job.
They went away with an incredible sense of accomplishment. There definitely is still the legacy going on. For the most part, they're all working. They've all changed their lives. They've all taken a step up in life.
Definitely, I wouldn't be here now if it wasn't for the opportunity of working in the fabrication shop. And as for the future, I've started my own business recently and I'm just working on that.
Vancouver was also the first host city to set up a not-for-profit organization during the bid process to create lasting community legacies in sport, the arts, literacy, and the environment. As a result of programs like Action Schools, over 400,000 students across British Columbia participated in programs that combined physical activity with health education. Today, the legacy lives on.
When you're active, you stay healthy.
Exercising is fun and it gets your body like going, so you're not all like stiff.
About 90% of schools are participating in this initiative. I have noticed that the children are a lot more aware. They're a lot more keener to actually participate and to work harder at school.
The world normally has to wait 4 years between Winter Games, but just 2 years after Vancouver, the Winter Youth Olympic Games was inaugurated in a city that was already steeped in Olympic tradition.
Good evening and welcome to the official opening ceremony of the first Winter.
The Youth Olympic Games has brought a new legacy to Innsbruck, helping to position it as a young and dynamic city and reinvigorating its Olympic history.
Well, the legacy of the Olympic Games of 1964 and 1976 is first of all the sports venues. All the venues that were used are still in use. That's a real legacy for the people of Innsbruck and the people in Tyrol. The second legacy is a touristic legacy, because everywhere you go in the world, people remember Innsbruck and the Olympic Games. So the Youth Olympic Games 2012 bring a reload of that trademark Olympics in connection with Innsbruck, and it's perfect for our tourism.
The games we've had so far have been so thrilling, and it's everything I imagined it would be.
It's great to race against people from all over the world, and you don't get better competition than here, and this is a real stepping stone to the Olympics.
My personal legacy is I'm responsible for all these Olympic sports venues. You know, what you are doing is not for the moment. It has been for over 50 years, and hopefully it will remain for the next 50 years.
Our journey began in Stockholm. 100 years later, we arrive here in Stratford, ready for the London 2012 Olympic Games. And as a nation holds its collective breath in anticipation. Right from the start, legacy was fundamental to the plan, with a very clear focus, the total transformation of the East End of London.
The theme of London 2012 is Inspire a Generation, and this transformation is built around a Games that's creating opportunities across sport, education, culture, volunteering and sustainability.
I joined Humanistics Bugles to pursue my dream in sprinting. When I found out that the Olympics is in East London, I was pretty excited, so I thought to myself, I want to be involved with it.
This is just a big opportunity just to be a part of it, just to contribute to it, just to be there, make history, you know. The fact that I'm going to be on a track with the athletes carrying the basket, it's like a little sample of how it's going to be when I'm doing it in 2016, hopefully.
We took a very broad view and we said, look, it's sport, it's music, it's arts, it's anything. It's a great opportunity and you badge it Olympics, but it's that inspiration, you take it all together and invest in young people.
The London Games are taking place in some remarkable new venues. But just like the Richmond Oval in Vancouver, they haven't simply been built for Games time impact, but for legacy as well. And afterwards, they'll be modified to meet the needs of local people and high-performance athletes long into the future.
We were determined that everything we invested in would have long-term benefit. And if there wasn't a good long-term use for a particular venue, then we would design it either as a temporary venue or we would try to find another location. The IOC in many ways sort of set the standards. It's very, very clear that when you're bidding for an Olympics, they're really looking for Olympic on Olympic improvements in terms of environmental performance.
Well, at the moment, it's a park that's in East London. What we wanted to be is a park for East London. The fences will come down and we're going to stitch it back into the community. And it's not about us telling the community what they want. It's about them telling us what they want to see here. And they're busy doing that at the moment.
The IOC is working alongside host cities to make sure that the Olympic Games changes people's lives, and not just the athletes who are taking part in them. But as we've seen, legacy, the long-term impact of the Games, doesn't just happen because a host city thinks it's a good idea. It has to be embedded in its bid and in its Games master plan. Meanwhile, the countdown to London 2012 is ticking. Let the Games begin.
Welcome to my workplace, carrying Usain Bolt's kit, maybe Johan Blake's. The 200 meter final is full of athletes. I'm inspired by being behind the people you look up to. It's amazing.
And so, Here we are, games time in the heart of the Olympic Park. The transformation is complete. Amazing venues, breathtaking sport, and a nation that has embraced the Olympic spirit. But more than that, this once derelict part of East London has become a shining beacon of what can be achieved when sport connects with a wider vision. An unbelievable event becomes the starting point for a longer lasting legacy.
I call it a social responsibility to have a sustainable legacy, because we cannot ask to have investment just for 2 weeks of competition. These investments are there for generations to come.